Well, I think the name of priest Pavel Florensky is rather known in Italy. They translated many works of Florensky, and they the first just in Italy named him Russian Leonardo. Well, really it's a very interesting figure and better to say the person in Russian culture of 20th century. Priest Pavel Florensky was a mathematician, philosopher, theologian, linguist, philosopher of art, engineer. They name, after Bolshevik Revolution, he has been repeatedly arrested, was in exile, and has been killed on Soloveitsky Islands, on Gulag, in the White Sea. They continue to publish his scientific and philosophical heritage till now. My paper has name following in the tracks of priest Pavel Florensky's philosophy of cult. Philosophy of cult is his work. The text of philosophy of cult was written fragmentary in 1908-1922 and has not been finished. Nevertheless, it is known that in 1918 Florensky gave in Moscow lectures on this topic, and after in the 20s prepared the typewritten text of this work. The main theme for Florensky is to underline the unreducibility of cult religious rites to their explanations, to beliefs, to theology, to mythology, in particular in antique religion as well. For him, was the very important thing for him was to stress the spiritual event of cult, and not the explanation or theological understanding of this event. In my lecture, I discuss especially the philosophy of culture, just on the base of his philosophy of cult. This is the first part of my lecture, and the second will be the continuation of these constructions on the history of philosophy. It will be the mine own application of his ideas. And the first one is a kind of the just to dispose what is the philosophy of culture of Pavel Florensky. The major value in Florensky constructions has the term orientation. This term goes from Kant, but after Florensky, its value is much more important than simply technical term of philosophy of transcendentalism. Characterizing concept of orientation, Florensky writes, quotation, "This concept is the highest property of the Western philosophy," end of quotation. Explaining the understanding of orientation in philosophy and culture, Florensky uses the well-known Gospels Christ saying, "For where is your treasure, there will be also your heart," Matthew chapter 6. Human heart freely selects that value by which the world outlook is guided. You know also the work of Max Scheler, Ordo Amoris, also dealing with this topic. What is your Ordo Amoris, and on this base you see the world. This value defined your orientation in the world, your understanding of the world. Florensky write anything like this. human this orientation expressions of special tendencies and declinations as presence of a special field of forces, if speak on the physical language, and is felt always in any complete outlook. Quotation. In general, it is possible to tell that the Christian philosophy is guided on Lord Jesus Christ, the pre-eternal embodied logos, and goes according to orientation on this. The end of quotation. Thereby, not only the philosophy, but also all the culture receives orientation to the chosen super value, the sacred. According to Florensky, a cult acts as a concrete ordering of everything in culture and in nature as well, according to the chosen orientation. If the person has gained through a choice a certain value, the sacred, then all his actions receive a corresponding estimation and form a certain system of movements in his life. The points of view, angles of view on reality, according to the chosen orientation, are actually categories in which the person comprehends the world. Any experience should be expressed through these categories. If it can't be expressed through them, it becomes ostensibility, only visibility, it is irreal. Though we see something, however, we recognize it only as an outward appearance. All the culture on Florensky is ordered concentrically in relation to the center cult on which it is focused. The etymology itself of the word culture speaks about it. Quotation of Florensky. The cult, cultus, from cholera to rotate, there is a circulation around dance, a swirling around a sacred reality, around the sacred. End of quotation. The Orthodox philosopher gives a set of vivid examples of orientation of Russian culture on cult realities in Orthodoxy. Fundamental orientation in space and time, for a long time we were cult-centered. Speaking about a city in Russia, we say it is so much kilometers from Moscow, from capital. However, the concept of capital is not simply geometric geographical term, or even not so much political, but rather cultural, including orientation to the beliefs selected by Russian people, the sacred. Moscow is the capital of Russia because in Moscow there are most of Christian relics, and this is a place of patriarch. Our measurement of time remains till now Christian as well. We speak, it is so much days from Christmas, from Easter. It was on Sunday. Sunday in Russian, Воскресенье. Literally, it means resurrection. Monday in Russian, it sounds понедельник, the first day after неделя. A неделя is the old name for the holiday of revival. Вторник, the second day after revival. Среда, the middle of the week. Thursday, Russian четверг, the fourth day. Friday, fifth day after revival. And суббота, the Bible name, etc. It is curious that even in the Soviet period, the time of domination of anti-Christian ideology, it was not possible to live from this general cult-centered scheme of culture. Though ideologists of the new power tried to change the calendar and also to destroy the basic Christian relics in Moscow, Kremlin, however, these plans have failed. Of course, the cult potential of the Soviet ideology has appeared more poorly than that of the traditional Christian one. And Soviet culture began gradually to imitate cultural forms of the Christian world. So we see in the space of Soviet culture triplicity, the pioneer, Komsomol, and the Communist Party, Marx, Engels, Lenin. The communist commandment appear, so-called the code of builders of communism, bureaus of rulers of the Soviet state and the Communist Party at the Kremlin wall enters into practice, a parody to bureau sacred places. And the relics, and the one have to say that the relics of the main of them, Lenin, lays till now on the main square of the country, Red Square, for worship, maybe. The space and time, fundamental characteristics of reality, are ordered on cult categories as well. Florensky confirms, even moreover, quotation, time and space are in cult derivatives. Time and space are in cult reality, but not on the contrary. The world in a cult, but not a cult in a world. The end of quotation. Speaking about orientation in philosophy, Florensky expresses a sort of culture orientation on a cult more precisely. Quotation. The philosophy by itself essence is not something other than a cognition and comprehension of the clever celestial transcendental world. But we know it, this world, only as a cult, as an embodiment of celestial world in our concrete symbols. The philosophy is therefore idealism, but not a venture just dealing with thoughts, but dealing with concrete contemplation and experience of clever essences of the cult. The end of quotation. As the main example, Florensky gives a comparative analysis of two great philosophers, Plato and Kant. Quotation. Plato's thought is essentially cult-centered. It is, as a matter of fact, the philosophical description and philosophical consciousness of mysteries. End of quotation. It is characteristic that Plato states vital issues in the form of myth and parables, in Phaedra, in State, in Timae. The central moment of Plato's philosophy tell us about the transcendental world. Memory of this world is a basis knowledge. The striving from the sensual world conducts to true knowledge, and wisdom consists actually in comprehension on the ontological self-transcendence of the world. All this, according to Florensky, indicates Plato's philosophy orientation on cult, most probable Eleusinian mysteries. Kant's orientation on cult, Christian cult, the cult of the incarnate logos, is negative, underlines Florensky. Quotation. The unique intelligent reality for Kant is he himself, and this erection of himself in the unconditional universe center excluded in advance from his thought any possibility of realities defined through from outside. In advance did him hostile to all the cults, and in advance induced to give such system of thought in which the cult would be impossible. It also was reached through basic and eternal division of sense and reality, spirit and flesh, truth and force. Division on two kingdoms, a kingdom of subjective truth and a kingdom of outside truth, reality. End of quotation. Restriction of a sphere of knowledge only to the area of phenomena and the announcement of sphere of sense and self inaccessible to knowledge, as well as purely moral interpretation of Christianity by Kant, a religion in boundaries of reason only. All this, according to Father Pavel Florensky, testifies Kant's pushing away from Kant, from a true reality shown in it. Kant and Plato appear here antipodes, end of quotation. Keeping Plato's terminology, Florensky says, keeping Plato's terminology and even communication of concepts, Kant takes Plato's life understanding and changes before it a sign from plus to minus. End of quotation. Kant's philosophy in this sense represents the statement of all philosophy, all outlook on human subjectivity, original self-idolatry. This is the first part what I wanted to say. Let's continue. The second part is just a kind of application of this idea, Florensky's idea about the cult-centered structure of culture to the field of philosophy. And so we want to show the spiritual roots of philosophy. Philosophy, as usually understanding, is the work of the lumen naturale rationis. Yeah? But the purpose of this paper is to show that in philosophy also there are some spiritual roots and which are necessary. One can't understand philosophical system if he don't have the communion with this spiritual root. Well, comparing Plato's philosophical concept and the Kant's one, Florensky faces the contradiction, which he, however, doesn't discuss. Plato's philosophy is positively focused on a cult, Kant's one negative. But in every case, one means the different cults, different religions. If in Kant's case, it is a Christian cult, in case of Plato, it is pagan, a religion of antiquity. Florensky writes unequivocally, quotation, the true reality in which relation only to speech about self-determination can exist is one. It is the realized sense or an intelligent reality. It is the incarnated logos. It is the cult, end of quotation. But Plato's positive orientation on cult is his orientation not on this cult, not on the cult of Christ logos. Behind this there is, of course, the most serious and basic question for Father Pavel Florensky about the relations of religion of pagan antiquity and Christianity. He in a sense, Florensky was a Platonist, and he understood this very well and talked about this not one time. However, as though it was, to recognize unconditionality, Plato's orientation to a Christian cult is impossible. Culture orientation, the orientation of philosophies in particular on a cult, is, after Florensky, expression of the basic axiom of the spirit given to us in the Gospel. For where is your treasure, there will be also your heart. Plato was orientated on the intuition of the sacred, sacred, true being as it was open to his time, as it was endured by adherents of the modern to him pagan cults. And he aspired to express this intuition philosophically. In this sense, we see that Florensky considers not only a unique true cult of Christian religion and the unique really open in it, the incarnate Christ Logos, but also other pagan cults and philosophical orientation on them. Similarly, Kant's cognition is Kant's conscious and persistent pushing away from Christian cult, which is undisputable, is nevertheless adoption of some other cult. After all, Father Pavel Florensky writes himself, quotation, "As a cult can oppose only a cult," end of quotation. What cult opposes Kant to Christianity? The cult of the self-affirmation human person, applying completely to supervise both his theoretical, practical activity and designing on this self-sufficient basis both the knowledge theory and morally and legal system, and even the true religion, as we know. More shortly, a cult of humanism. The question about spiritual sense of this cult leaves actually the framework of philosophy and can be discussed more likely in theology, namely in theology of culture. Though in 20th century there were systems of thought which aspired to fix this special spiritual character of different directions of culture. So, for example, in Karl Jaspers' existentialism, among the different horizons of encompassing, umgreifende, in Deutsch, to which the person belongs, there is also a spirit horizon, Geist horizon, as a certain cultural spiritual generality uniting adherents of school, adherents of sects, members of parties, national and ethnic societies. Anyway, we consider that the similar spiritual characteristic of philosophical system is a necessary moment of its understanding, comprehension of its place in the history of thought and cultural history. Presence of these spiritual moments in philosophical systems is connected with two essential factors. The first one, as analysis show, the central positions of philosophical system having even purely logic form appear nevertheless not convincing completely undoubtedly. This logic appears not completely universal. Atmosphere of constant scandal is traditional in philosophy. What is obvious to one philosophy is not at all like this for another. For example, Descartes' cogito. It means that fundamental philosophical theses, quite often, contrary to the statement of their authors, are not reduced only to purely logic positions, are comprised something irreducible to logic, irrational. This last is connected usually with some willing choice of will, orientation to some value, sometimes even insufficiently realized by the philosopher himself. In this sense, fundamental philosophical statement acts not as any proof, but as a certificate of the volition, as an act of volitional adoption of some value, the act of personal self-determination, sometimes only a little bit covered with logic constructions. The second moment. Philosophical system arises not in empty space, not in vacuum, total absence of cultural preconditions. Philosophical systems have the internal and external history. The feeling of ties of these systems with wider cultural and historical traditions allows us to speak about, for example, Enlightenment philosophy or Enlightenment motifs or philosophy of Romanticism or Renaissance philosophy, etc. It is curious that promotion of basic philosophical statements around which philosophical systems are then constructed has original cult-like character. Cult-like character. We repeat that usually only logic is not enough for acceptance of these basic statements. Here always the human will participates also. The adoption of such statement as a basic center of system has a character of some confession of truth, which is not reduced neither to logic conclusion nor to purely strong-willed impulse, though contains both of them, and represents original event in spiritual history of the person. In one's turn, understanding the use of this basic statement have a character of original spiritual initiation, in which the certain fusion of logic, will, and more widely the spiritual is accepted as some norm of the true. Speaking spiritual initiation, we again underline this cult-like character of this event, irreducible neither to logic formula nor to purely will's impulse. A person should endure something in the internal spiritual experience that the offered philosopher could be acquired, clear, and capable to justify all the philosophical system. Having been endured as the true, this spiritual event becomes further an original lantern with which help all is shining then. In a Nietzsche cult-like spiritual self-determination, that type of true was chosen, which defines norms of understanding, intuition of the clearly, the understanding, and the proved, etc. Example of classical philosophers allow to understand better the above stated. Descartes. Descartes' cogito, being grain of his system, caused disputes already during the lifetime of his creator. Pater Mersenne has published in 1640 the whole book of the objections directed against constructions of Cartesius. Since then, disputes about cogito ergo sum did not cease. What does this statement mean? Either is it some conclusion, the proof, or it is an identical statement, type A is equal to A? How Cartesian cogito and the question of God's existence correspond one another? It is necessary for Descartes for construction of science system. All these questions are hotly discussed today as well. Nevertheless, despite controversial initial philosophy, Descartes generates the whole tradition of thought and even of culture. In this tradition, there is not only Cartesian cogito, but also European individualism of a lonely thinker sitting in his well and exclusively from itself, weaving as a spider a web of his system. Here we see also the idea of Mathesis Universalis, the titanic project of automatization of human thinking. In this system, God also had own place after Helsinki, God of philosophers and scientists instead of God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, as Descartes' contemporary ingeniously sensitive Pascal remarked. This system of thought, culture system, constantly tied with Cartesian's initial cult-like philosophy, exists till now. What is this culture? In general, it is a culture of modern secular society based on human reason, lumen naturale rationis, on science, on certain methodical installation, clearness, distinctness, decomposition of the difficult, according to Descartes, on common sense. In this culture, there is a place even to God, but in a definite deism's sense. Philosophers receive communion to this culture through mastering of ideas of Descartes' method and through acceptance of cogito. If the fundamental doubt with which Descartes begins his reasoning is authorized by acceptance of cogito, then it defines character type of this clearness, distinctness, which will be cultivated further. The radical doubt can conduct much further than Descartes has shown. It can conduct even to despair. People agreeing with Descartes make together with him an act of spiritual and intellectual self-determination. They appear as some united society. Their new knowledge appears a uniting them consciousness. Consciousness. Consciousness together. Thinking together. Consciousness. More shortly, expressing the Christian terms, they are catholicized in this general form, in this general for them true philosophical confession. The use of religious terms here are not casually. In one of the central places of an Orthodox liturgy, the deacon proclaims, "Let's love each other, having identity of mind in the Father and the Son, Saint Spirit." Love, the highest affinity between people, is inseparable from identity of mind. The unity of Christians in church is sought to be carried out similarly to unity of persons of Trinity. In Christian cult, people are catholicized in confession of Christian love given by Saint Spirit. Our thesis is that there are other types of catholicizing, in particular through participation in a philosophical tendency. Certainly, these different types of catholicizing are not completely equivalent. They are of different type of and degrees. They have the different depths. There is a whole hierarchy of type of catholicizing. It is not place to discuss this question in its completeness now. Now it is important for us only to underline that the ancestry to concrete philosophical tradition and even its learning is not simply a mastering logic reasoning, but an initiation to some spiritual reality. Similarly, one can say about Kant's moral teaching. Kant's moral doctrine is constructed on a categorical imperative. It is known, however, high words which were found by Kant for praise the call of duty expressed in his basic moral law. That, that quotation from Kant, that you raised a great word, in you are not present anything pleasant that would flatter people. You demand submission. You only establish the law, which by itself gets into soul and even against will can get respect for. End of quotation. However, contrary to this pathos of Kant, persuasiveness of its moral doctrine, and particularly the unconditional importance of categorical imperative at all, are not so obvious. The criticism of these positions has begun at once after the publications of Critical of Practical Reason and does not stop till now. Whether it is undisputable that the moral person is guided by a pure abstract principle, categorical imperative, instead of any life inclination, as writes, for example, one of the domestic critics of Kantianism in Life. Whether are valid postulates of practical reason, existence of God, soul, and immortality. Whether they are deduced from a categorical imperative or actually he assumes them from Christianity. Besides, the categorical imperative is formal and very wide. Whether so, moral behavior, whether from this moral behavior inevitably falls. If to the some debauchee, the seducer of children, for example, we tell you incorrectly does. You should operate so that rules of your will could be principles of the general legislation. Perhaps he can answer, certainly, I also act for it. Anything in my behavior is not present bad. Let's all do like this. Unless the similar position breaks norms of categorical imperative. But anyway, we should ascertain again that Kant's moral doctrine has generated the whole tradition of construction of independent morals, independent first of all from religious precepts. This tradition is influential enough. It has affected even the divinity. It exists until now. And it is not casual. Kant's categorical imperative lie on sufficient spiritual depths to provide this cult-centered character of self-determination of human mind and will, which can serve as a certain reference of point in moral sphere. Not everybody agree with this orientation, and much those who consider it doubtful and even false. Christian ideal of morals formulated in the Sermon on the Mount with its precept, love your enemies, is another one. you on one cheek, substitute also the second one. Much above that moral in Kant we have a kind of an equality, but in Christianity there is no this equality. By the way, Kant eloquently describes this generality, the people divined under ethical laws when designed the church united and like historical belief, pure religious belief. The number of examples could be increased. The similar understanding of philosophy is not invented by us for the first time. Many great philosophers of the past marked religious aspects of their philosophical making. It is necessary to remember Socrates' well-known demon. We want to underline, however, that not only those moments of philosophizing which are traditionally connected with religious experience, reasoning on God, spirits, etc., are tied with this spiritual dimension of philosophy, but quite often the purely logic constructions as well. The philosophy of one and many in Plato's Parmenid is not simply logic reasoning. It is an immersion in specific mystical atmosphere of pure thought and a communion to it. Hegel, in his Science of Logic, says directly that he is engaged here in an original sort of mysticism. Schleiermacher, speaking about intuition of the infinite, connects it directly with religion basis, etc. Conclusion. Human thought is not a purely subjective psychological act. In its roots, the thought enigmatically touches the being itself, makes the objective and valid judgments about it. This thesis always was and remains in the history of philosophy both the deepest insight and the most audacious project. Trying to realize how this contact of being by thought is going on, we find out mystical religious roots of thought. According to Florensky, it is a definition itself of cult, the moment of life experienced in which ideal and material, subjective and objective, interpenetrate. In the sense of Christian metaphysics, it is a certain distinction of spirits for which we are called. Citation: Beloved, don't believe every spirit, but test the spirits, whether they are of God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. 1 John chapter 4. Thank you.